Please be seated.
A very good morning to you all, and a very, very warm welcome to our service this Christmas Eve. If you've not been before, my name is Vivian. I'm the session clerk here at Kirkgate, and it's lovely to have all of you with us this morning. We'll be having tea and coffee after the service today, so if you want to join us for that, you would be very welcome. If you leave by that door there and go straight across to the hall, you'll get your tea and coffee and a wee goody to go with it. So we look forward to chatting to some of you then. There will be a watch night service in Park Church at 11:30 tonight. And there's a service here in Kirkgate tomorrow at the slightly earlier time of 10:30. So 10:30 tomorrow for the Christmas Day service. Musical Memories with Mary is on this week on Wednesday at 2:00, and you're all more than welcome to come along to that. The Thursday service at 10:30, and the Channel Lunch is on, as usual, on Friday at 12:30. I think these are all the intimations, so let's get on with the service.
Thank you very much, Vivian. It's been a week. I've been off, and I must say it was not the best because I wasn't well. So I spent most of the time trying to sleep. So I would prepare the boys, run with them, and come back home and sleep. I think it was a well-needed rest. But I would like to pour my heart to all of you. I'm aware among us, members of North Parish Church and many other churches that are part of today. But I thought it's important to share my heart with you concerning what has been happening concerning the Presbytery Mission Plan. I'm sure by now, all of you, whenever you hear Presbytery Mission Plan, you go, oh. It has been a journey. It has been a painful journey for many people, and I do acknowledge that. Many people are hurting. Some have been hurt, some have gone past it. Some are still hurting today. And I must say, I've not been prone to the hurt as well. I've been hurting in the process as well. Just to offer you a bit of background, some of you don't know me. I was born and bred and battered in Zimbabwe. And I grew up in Zimbabwe with so much contact with the Church of Scotland. And when I received a call to ministry, it was in 2003, 20 years ago in August. That's when I said, yes, Lord, I want to do this. So 20 years ago, I received a call in Zimbabwe. And through the call, I was privileged to go to a university in South Africa where I did my studies until I completed my studies. And I started serving God in South Africa. And after some time serving in South Africa, I felt like I needed to be fair and go back to Zimbabwe for some few years. So in Zimbabwe, there's an appointment setting. So I was appointed for 2 years in one church in Bulawayo. You might not know this. So I served 2 years, and then God called me back again to South Africa, and I served for 3.5 years. And already by then, I had had a call on my life to come serve in the Church of Scotland. You might be thinking, why am I bothering with this? But I want to show you that when it comes to a call, God calls you and you go. 3 years and some months back, I responded to a call when this particular church called me. I had no idea what I was getting into. But I don't regret the fact that God has called me. So three years and I was only inducted 1 month ago, 3 years ago, in November. But it has been a journey. I've said that for you so that you understand where I've come from. So to some degree, when it comes to attachment to buildings, I'm more attached to people than buildings. And of course, I do respect and I believe in our church governance and you name it. And I do believe that what the church is doing is necessary. As to the how and other things, I'll leave that for another day. So in the process, this whole year we've been up and talking about Presbytery Mission Plan and you name it. And you've been told last Sunday of the last results where 2 churches have voted to go ahead and then one has now voted not to go ahead. And I must say, from the onset, I had, from my background, an understanding that we have to do this together. But unfortunately, there is an end to everything. So last week during my leave, 1 week off, and I don't know why it happened. It happened on my wife's birthday. And for those who don't know, she is my savior. What that means is she saves a lot of me when I go off the hook sometimes. But so with that, on the 13th of December, when the vote went the way it went, I've now decided, I've given you all this background so that you understand, from the onset, I was consulted as well to give what is called a consent for the process to go ahead. In other words, from the beginning of the talk about Presbytery Mission Plan and the Union of Churches, I had the privilege to say, I don't want, you can talk about union but not talk about involving me. But I didn't do that because of where I came from, because of my background. But now I've come to a place where I've said, I think I've done my part. And all of you, you've also done your part. So I have now officially withdrawn my consent. What that means is, yes, there will be talk about union in the new year, but because of my position as the minister who was called on unrestricted tenure at Kegate Parish Church, I've said no more talk that involves me. So yes, union will come at some stage, but as long as God has not taken me away from this place for a while, it will be a pause. I hope that is well explained. So yes, in the new year, the presbytery will do what the presbytery does best, to come, talk to people, and try and pave a way forward. All I can say for now, next year, this year, up until next year, this year, so far, that's what I know for sure. I don't want to talk about union anymore. I feel like we need to pause. So you'll find, as we begin the new year, in my prayerful time, that week that was supposed to be resting time and sleeping time, I've spent time asking God, what is it that you want for your people? So beginning 2024, we're going to be starting on a series where God is inviting us. God is inviting us to a new look, a new start, a new looking into what is mission for us as people. And I think, God willing, by all means, I know this is hurting, it hurts all of us, but I think for 2024, we need to start on a fresh page where we are saying, God, what are you expecting of us? And starting on the 7th, I'll be preaching the first invitation where God is inviting his people to something. So hopefully that will be good. So I'm part of the crew that you can see on your left, or maybe on your right, some of you. So to start with, we're going to listen to some music. Ethan is going to play for us, so relax and enjoy as Ethan introduces to us our lovely, is he there? All right, over to you, Ethan.
On our way to Bethlehem with the Holy Family. The shepherds. The angels. The magi. And the stars. The time of Advent is so important. Sometimes people can walk right through a mystery and not even know it is there. This time of the year, you will see people hurrying in the malls and buying things and doing this and that. but they will miss the mystery. They don't know how to get ready. Or maybe they just forgot. The church learned a long time ago that people need a way to get ready to enter or even come close to a mystery like Christmas. On the third Sunday in Advent, we remember the shepherds who were standing in the fields around Bethlehem, keeping their sheep. They were trying to stay awake so the wolves could not come and get the sheep. Suddenly, there was so much light in the sky that it hurt their eyes. They were afraid. Their hearts were beating so loudly. When they could hear something besides their own hearts, they thought they heard singing in the sky. That also scared them until they heard the words of the song. The angels were singing. Angels often say that because it is scary to have a messenger of God come to you. The angel singing sounded something like this. Don't be afraid. We bring you tidings of great joy, peace on earth and goodwill to everyone. A child is born. Go, hurry, run to Bethlehem to see the child who will change everything. On the fourth Sunday in Advent, we remember the Magi, the three wise men. They came from far in the east, and they were so wise that people thought they were magic. In fact, we get our word magic from the name they were called in their own language, the Magi. Of all the things they knew the most about the stars. They knew where each star was supposed to be at each time of the year. So they could tell people when it was time to plant their crops, or take a trip on the ocean in a boat, or cross the high mountain passes when the snow wasn't too deep. Suddenly, they saw the wild star. It was not on any of their maps. It went where it wanted to go. It did not stay put. Suddenly, they saw the wild star. It was not on any of their star maps. It went where it wanted to go. It did not stay put. They decided to follow the wild star to see where it was going and what it wanted to show them. They followed the star all the way to Bethlehem, but they came from so far that they got there after the baby was born. They are always late, it seems. Every year they are late. When you come to the mystery of Christmas, everything changes. It becomes the color of pure celebration. This is when the baby is born, the one we have been waiting for. Here is the Christ child, the mystery of Christmas. This is amazing. But of all the creatures there that night, Perhaps the most amazed one was the old cow. When the old cow came up to feed in the box to eat some straw, it found a baby lying in the manger. Someone had put a soft cover over the straw. The manger had become a bed. All the old cow could do was look and look at the baby with its big brown eyes. Wait, something is missing. I wonder what it could be. Here is the light of the prophets. The Holy Family. The shepherds. The wise men. And the Christ candle. Now let's enjoy the light. Let's enjoy the light. Now I'm going to change the light. Look how it is spreading out to fill up the room. As it spreads out, it gets thinner and thinner until you can't see it at all. That doesn't mean that it's gone. It only means that you can see it. You can still feel the Christmas light. It is filling up the room with the prophets, the Holy Family, the shepherds, the angels, and the three kings. Anywhere you go, you can come close to them. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I once was training people and I was going straight after someone who is absolutely brilliant, who is literally doing cartwheels and stuff. And you sometimes feel as if you're going to be a very poor second. So that was absolutely brilliant. Thank you so much to all the children again. Fantastic. Let's join together now then in our call to worship. Let's join together in prayer. In you, gracious God, the widowed find a carer, the orphaned find a parent, the fearful find courage. In you, gracious God, the wounded find healing, the penitent find a pardoner, the burdened find a counselor. In you, Jesus Christ, we meet our God and our Lord. Open our minds and our hearts today for all that you may have to teach us. Amen. Let's join together in our first song, which is Joy Has Dawned Upon the Earth. We're now going to join together in our prayer of adoration and praise, and Ruth is leading us for that.
Let us pray. Father God, our mighty and wonderful Saviour, we come before you this morning to worship and adore you, to celebrate your goodness, love, and mercy, which you bestow upon us, whether we are worthy or not. You are our God. Our God is real, and we are all your children. Without you, Lord, we can do nothing. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the sure and certain knowledge that you are with us always. And we pray that you will bless us with humility, generosity, grace, and love, enabling us to share our many blessings with those in need, not only in our own communities, but around our world. Mighty God, as we anticipate coming together to celebrate this Christmas, remind us to keep those in our prayers who are feeling lost, abandoned, sad, or alone. We pray for those who are grieving, facing this special time without loved ones, perhaps for the first time. We pray that they will find comfort in you, our sovereign God. Precious Lord, we pray for those amongst us and around the world who face trials and tribulations, that they may know the peace and mercy of your unfailing grace. Most gracious God, we pray for peace, the peace that only you can bring in these troubled times of war in Ukraine, in the Middle East, and in all other conflicts throughout our world. Merciful God, we pray for the peace that passeth all understanding. We pray for peace in our own hearts and for the courage and compassion to reach out to those estranged from us while we still can. Father God, we thank you for the freedom to worship and for the certainty and foreknowledge revealed in your holy scriptures, where Isaiah prophesied, "Unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Heavenly Father, as we wait in anticipation and excitement to celebrate your most precious gift to us, the birth of your only Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, born in a humble stable, we are blessed by the certainty that our God is real. Our God is alive. Our God is with us. And we are redeemed by the precious blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you, Ruth. So, good morning to the children that remain with us. So, hello to you all. What day is it tomorrow? Who can give me a little shout out? What day is it tomorrow? Go for it. Christmas, are you sure? Christmas Eve tomorrow. Excellent, I'm out of track. I'm off track. Christmas Day, oh, goodness me. So Christmas Day is tomorrow. Nothing much as exciting is happening on Christmas Day, is it? No? Nothing too much exciting happening on Christmas Day? Jesus was born. That's a brilliant answer. That is an absolutely superb answer. In fact, I think you're all back in church tomorrow, and we're going to be reading from the phone book tomorrow for about 3 or 4 hours instead. So it sounds pretty good. I'm joking. Of course, you're absolutely right. Tomorrow is Christmas Day. And I'm going to show you some pictures, and I'm going to see if you can work out what they might be for me. So I'm looking for some shouting out. An orange. Excellent. Fantastic. The picture didn't even get up for more than a second, and we got an orange. Super. An orange, or in this case, it's actually a satsuma. So there we go. You've learned something. We've got something next, which some people might recognize. Gabby. Yes, so Gabby's dollhouse, which is popular with some little girls, I hear, and some little boys too. So we've got Gabby's dollhouse up there, and it looks as if there might be some pictures of some of those. This was something that was about when I was a kid, but apparently it's coming back. Moon shoes, well done. These are shoes that you bounce about on. You're absolutely right. Dobble, well done. It's a game that you can potentially play. You are absolutely spot on, well done. And then I've got one last one for you. Lego, excellent. I got a heck of a lot of adults shouting that one out, so well done. Clearly that's a popular one with some of the adults still as well. It is with me, so well done. What is it that links all of these things? What could they be? Go on. They could potentially be all presents. You're absolutely right. So they could potentially all be presents. Go on. No, we've changed our mind. That's okay. That's all right. Tell me later. I'll be interested in what you're going to say. So we could potentially get presents at Christmas time because Jesus got presents at his birth. Now, there are some children who are a bit older than most of you that were asked some questions. So they're a wee bit older than most of yourselves, but they were asked some questions. And the first question they were asked to think about 3 Christmases ago. 1, 2, 3. 3 Christmases ago. And they were asked to think, what presents did you get 3 Christmases ago? And I think some of the adults might be struggling with that too. And you know, that was a good escaping there, I like that. Surprise, it wasn't my own children. So they couldn't actually remember. And some of you might not be able to remember that either. They really couldn't remember some of the presents that they got a couple of years ago. Then they were asked an important question. They were asked, what do you actually remember about past Christmases? And one kid said, I remember walking in the snow with my gran. And another kid said, I remember making Christmas cards with my friends at school. And another said, I'm just always so happy at Christmas time because my mum doesn't have to work. And another said, I got to trap my cousin behind the Christmas tree and he had to knock it over to be able to get out from under there. They didn't remember the presents that they got a couple of years ago. That memory had disappeared. Instead, what they remembered was the time that they had with others. And I've got a little image here that says, the very best gift is time. So amongst all those children, they were asked about all those presents, which is something a lot of kids think of at Christmas time. But actually, what they remembered was the time that they spent. And we might think, well, that can't be true. Surely kids are only interested in presents. Well, they remembered the times. For us, we have to remember the first Christmas story today that we hear in the Bible. And it's all about love. It's all about the time that Jesus chose to spend with us on earth. God looked at the world at Christmas time, and he looked at you, and he looked at me, and he said, I want to be with you because I love you. I want to walk with you as Jesus, and I want to walk with you and give you hope and give you love. Many of us won't have this year the fancy Christmases that you can see on TV, but it was never meant to be like that at all. So this Christmas, boys and girls, as you head out to go to Sunday school, remember Christmas is about love, the love of Jesus, and the love and time that you spend with one another. Let's think about that now as we watch a song together on the screen. And it's Come All Ye Faithful. Let's join together in prayer. Lord, take our offerings such as they are. As we offer, remind us of the offering of the poor widow from the Gospel of Mark. Our offerings are seen by you and are known by you. We know that our offerings of time, talents, and love aren't judged by you as inadequate when we give with all our hearts. Today, Lord, remind us to offer up our worries, our anxieties, and all the concerns that we have and cast them onto you. Remind us that we can come to you in prayer just as we are, as broken or as whole as we are, and you see us and you love us. Amen. Amen. No worries. We are now going to have our reading for today. If you were here last week, the reading may be somewhat familiar to you from last week. So it's Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 20. And Ian is going to do our reading for today.
Promised in marriage to him. She was pregnant, and while they were in Bethlehem, the time came for her to have her baby. She gave birth to her first son, wrapped him in strips of cloth, and laid him in a manger. There was no room for them to stay in the inn. The shepherds and angels. There were some shepherds in that part of the country who were spending the night in the fields, taking care of their flocks. And the angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone over them. They were terribly afraid. But the angel said to them, "Don't be afraid. I am here with good news for you, which will bring great joy to all the people. This very day in David's town, your Saviour was born, Christ the Lord. And this is what will prove it to you. You will find a baby wrapped in strips of cloth and lying in a manger." Suddenly a great army of heaven's angels appeared with the angels saying praises to God. Glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth to those with whom he is pleased. When the angels went away from them back into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and saw the baby lying in the manger. When the shepherds saw him, they told them what the angel had said about the child. All who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said. Mary remembered all these things and thought deeply about them. The shepherds went back singing praises to God for all they had heard and seen. It had been just as the angel had told them. May God add his blessing to this reading of Holy Word and to glory God. Thank you.
In. Let's sing together now our next song, which is In the Bleak Midwinter. just before the pandemic and before I had children myself, I was working a number of different shifts at the bank that I worked at. And regardless of what shift I was on, an early shift, 7 o'clock in the morning till 3 in the afternoon, or one of the dreaded late shifts, 3 o'clock in the afternoon till 11 at night, there was a guy that I knew that was there every single day. And he was working absolutely tons of overtime. He looked knackered. He looked beyond knackered whenever I saw him, and I felt very bad for him. I knew him a little bit, and I was a bit curious and a little bit nosy as well. So I went over to him and I asked, "What's with all the overtime?" And he said to me, "I've got 2 teenage kids and I've got to pay for their Christmases." And I laughed a little bit, little did I know then, and I said, "It can't be that bad." And he just looked at me for a couple of seconds, and then he rolled off some prices that he clearly had got memorized. And he said, "A laptop each, £1,200. A phone each, £600. Clothes each, £500. By the way, that's each, not in total. Beauty products for one of them, £200. The list went on and on and on and on. And it was at the back of my mind to sort of say to him, "That sounds good, but what on earth are you going to do next Christmas?" But I didn't ask that. It wouldn't have been nice to ask that at all. I just simply said, "That's a lot." And he said, "Yes," in a resigned voice. And he went back to work and started to walk back over to his desk. And he sort of explained to me as we were walking that they went to a very good school, and it was the norm for anyone who went to that school to buy loads of stuff for their kids. And if you didn't buy loads of stuff, then you were a bad parent. Now, we might rush to judgment a wee bit here and say that's absolutely mad sums of money to spend. Now I've got children of my own, I can kind of start to imagine some of those pressures that might start coming in for paying for some of the more expensive things that kids might want. We chatted for a while, and as I was leaving, he said in a resigned voice, "It's just what Christmas is all about though, isn't it? It's just what Christmas is all about." Is that right? Is that what Christmas is all about? Well, when we look on our TV and on social media, we might be forgiven for thinking that everyone is getting loads of stuff and everyone is eating loads of food, fantastic meals, and everything is absolutely perfect. I've got some images for you just now, and I did a little bit of a search for perfect Christmases and related images like that. So we've got a Christmas dinner here, and the first thing that I notice is that everyone looks happy. That doesn't seem real to me on that front. There's absolutely going to be at least one person who looks absolutely miserable at that point in time as they go round. Everyone seems to be really happy, and no one's on their phones at all. So it doesn't look quite real at all, does it? And then I found this little picture here. There's two of them together. And these are pictures that you can see. If you look on social media for presents, you'll find these pictures where people have got mountains, they call it, of presents. Quite a lot to get through there. Our reality, though, may be very different to those images. For many of us, Christmas involves empty chairs where loved ones once sat instead of those smiling faces that we saw. For many of us, Christmas involves poverty instead of excess. For many of us, Christmas involves painful reminders of things, health conditions, the fragility of life, loss, and all sorts of disappointments that we've suffered along the way in life. But perhaps that kind of Christmas is more in line with what Christmas really is. And there's a few reasons that I say that. So let's go back to our verse in Luke for a moment, and we should be reminded of two key things from the Christmas story that give me a great deal of hope. First of all, Jesus was born in Bethlehem. One of the ministers that I listen to on podcasts, a guy called Skip Heitzig, he's been to Bethlehem many times, and he describes it in this way. He says, it's a run-down nothing of a town. He said, nothing much of interest is there, and it's not changed too much in 2,000 years. It's not a great place to visit at all. I doubt the Bethlehem Tourist Board would be all that keen on having him as their spokesperson. In that dubious town, which at that point in time was full to bursting, different biblical scholars argue over exactly where Jesus was born. Some argue that the Greek word phante, which is used here in Luke, might mean either manger or a part of the house where the animals are kept. Regardless of which one it is, and some might even argue that it's a family home or an inn, but regardless of where it is, it's not the place that we would expect the Son of God to be born into. The Jewish people were waiting for a Messiah. They were expecting a king. They were expecting a warrior from a princely line that was descended all the way back to King David. You might expect that kind of king or warrior to be born into somewhere of great wealth and great affluence and great power. But that's not where God chooses. That's not where God chooses for his son to be born. I've got a little image here that I like, and it's from a TV show called The Chosen, and they did a Christmas special. And you can't really sort of make it out, but this is the birth of Jesus. And if you look sort of slightly to the side of the image here, you can see mess. You can see poverty. You can see blood. You can see sweat. You can see tears. It looks real. That's what I imagine when I think of where Jesus was born. Secondly, why I think Christmas is more realistic when it's something that acknowledges our struggles is the shepherds. If you look at different sources, you'll find different reasons as to why people didn't like the shepherds. And there's lots of different reasons quoted as to why people thought shepherds weren't any good at all. As I mentioned earlier on, my job for 20 years was working in a bank. And if I ever had to get into a taxi whilst going to a different location working for a bank, I heard from taxi drivers many different reasons why people didn't like banks. And so I sympathise to a certain extent with the shepherds here. There were many different reasons people didn't like shepherds. In his book, Jesus and the Gospels, Craig Blomberg said that shepherds had a reputation for theft. So there's a reputation that followed them that they might steal things from you. And in the book, Shepherds After My Own Heart, Timothy Lanick says that their despised nature was often due to how nomadic they were and how they never really settled in one place. And in William Barclay's commentaries, he says about how shepherds were disliked because they couldn't keep up all the rituals of hand washing and ceremonial bathing, and so would be seen as a bit unclean. So there's loads of different reasons why shepherds were disliked. They were not picture perfect. They were a group of people, therefore, that would be looked down on. But these are exactly the kinds of people that Jesus came into the world for. As well as symbolizing the Good Shepherd approach of Jesus' ministry, they clearly show the type of people that God lifts up throughout the whole Bible. These aren't the type of people with picture-perfect lives. They wouldn't be the type of people in this day and age with piles of presents under the tree. In Jesus, God shows his true nature. He shows what he is like. In Christmas, God knows exactly what he values. So in our Christmas story, we see that God turns his back on the idea of a Messiah being born into wealth and power. And he chooses for the Messiah to be born from a seemingly insignificant peasant girl, in a seemingly insignificant town, in dirt, in poverty, in humble surroundings. In our Christmas story, we see that God turns his back on the idea of the Messiah being surrounded by the influential, by the celebrities, by the powerful, and by the kings. God chooses those who are disliked and mistrusted to visit him in the manger. The outcast and the stranger are welcomed into his presence. You see, Christmas isn't about the expectations society now has. It's not about the carefully curated photos that you can see of matching pajamas, the thousands of pounds worth of Christmas presents under the tree, the perfect family, or the perfect meals. Christmas is about understanding that God so loved the world that he would not let it go. God looked at you, and he looked at me, in all our imperfections, in our darkest moments, and God chose to walk alongside us. Not as a king, not as a prince, not as a wealthy influencer or a celebrity, but as the kind of man God that walks by our side in day-to-day life. The God who knows what it's like. I'd like to leave you with a thought from Reverend Kramer in the US. And he said this: it would be quite the fragile God who needed power, riches, and wealth to enforce their will. It is quite the powerful God who partners with peasants, is born into poverty, washes feet, heals the sick, advocates for the oppressed, is unjustly killed, and yet still changes the entire world. So this Christmas, regardless of what it looks like, regardless of what empty seats or worries are on our mind, know that God loves you and God walks by your side. Thanks be to God. Let's join together in singing On Christmas Night, All Christians Sing.
Thank you.
Let's join together in our prayers for others. And our prayers for others today come from a prayer by Shane Claiborne and his Liturgy for Ordinary Radicals. Let's pray. Our loving Father, make us worthy of serving our brothers and sisters throughout the world who live and die in poverty. Give them today love, peace, and dignity. Our loving Father, make us worthy of working for peace in the places round the world where war rages, Gaza, the Ukraine, and many others. Make us worthy of serving our brothers and sisters this Christmas who face poverty, isolation, illness, and depression. May you work through us to be an answer to their prayers. Make us worthy of serving our brothers and sisters this Christmas who face the first Christmas alone without a beloved family member or friend. May you work with us and work in us to comfort them. Make us worthy of serving our brothers and sisters this Christmas who are so poor that all they have is money and possessions. May you work with us to help them to see that you offer life to the full and a comfort that things and stuff will never bring. Lord, in a moment's silence, we quietly name all of the places and situations that are on our minds today. We join our hearts together for all those prayers, and we ask you to hear our words. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Our closing song then today is Hark the Herald Angels.
Thank you.
May God bless us with discomfort at easy answers, half-truths, and superficial living, so that we may live deep within our hearts. May God bless us with anger at injustice, oppression, and exploitation of God's creation, so that we may work for justice, freedom, and peace. And now, may the adventure, the joy, and the peace of knowing Jesus go with you into the world. And may his grace, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you this Christmas and always. Amen.